I'm going to be disruptive in at least the format, since I have two or three slides to illustrate things, because we've, and I'll also be doubly disruptive because I'm going to talk about numbers and figures, but also respond to your first question is why Africa? Why Africa for a Moroccan company? I think my colleague Mrs. Bensaleh has responded in terms of almost geopolitics, but you know the answer is to correct a perception gap of which we are still suffering today. You know, Morocco is an African country, and yet for the perception of many institutions, international, private or public, it is not part of Africa. Since we're lumped into something called MENA. Indeed, we are Arabs, we are part of MENA, but it overlooks the fact that we are fully African. And this has consequences. I mean, when we, as a company, try to develop partnerships with other companies from the West, from the North, we usually cannot speak to the African department. It's sub-Saharan Africa. So this, and also when we address development agencies, it is the case. So there is a perception gap. But why Africa for a company that has an interest in fertilizer, thereby agriculture? The first slide is a response to this. I have personally lived already a revolution that I would call a digital revolution in Africa. Several years ago, mobile development in Africa, we have to recognize, surprised everybody. I was at that time a telecom regulator here in Morocco, and then moved to the World Bank to advise African countries on telecom reforms. But there was a lag between investments from northern countries and also development institutions recognizing the potential of the mobile revolution. The same thing may be happening for agriculture. If you look at the challenges, the population challenge Mr. Bayer has already mentioned, but what it translates in terms globally of arable land per capita is globally a decreasing amount of arable land per capita. And if you look at where the remaining arable land on the planet exists, it's in Africa. 60% of remaining arable land not used is in Africa. And that represents 80% also of the arable land in Africa. The second slide tells you what the ingredients of a green revolution. And I would say that for Africa, you mentioned the environment, it has to be a doubly green revolution. It has to be a green revolution in the sense of agriculture, but that has also to be very responsible in terms of protecting the environment and protecting, for example, Africa's biodiversity, very rich diversity. So it has to be a doubly green revolution. And you mentioned AAA, which is a Moroccan initiative to actually see that the correlation between agriculture and environment is not and does not have to be negative. By bringing nutrients to the soil, we can actually increase the CO2 capture potential of the soils. But here you see how fertilizers have always been key to unleash a green revolution. You mentioned our past in with Brazil, with South America supporting a green revolution there. You could also have mentioned India, where that also has lived the green revolution with maybe a different focus. India was more self-sufficiency, and Brazil was exporting and feeding the rest of the world. We think that Africa is going to be the latter, feeding the rest of the world. You saw the figures. Now, we're seeing some African countries, this is why I said there may be a second surprise. The first was a mobile surprise. The green revolution is still creating, is still not fully recognized, I would say. It's potential in there, but in terms of, now I'm going to move to what's really happening on the ground, there are very important signs. Here are three countries that are catching up through a mix of public-private policies very fast in terms of fertilizer. You know, from a, you know, Guinea has last year multiplied by five its fertilizer consumption. And I have to add, this is reasoned fertilization. Those are fertilizer formulas that have been tailor-made to avoid any environmental degradation for Guinea. In fact, for the other two countries, exactly the same. Nigeria and Ethiopia, you see now really policymakers putting in place the right types of policies. This is, for example, the Ethiopian situation. After a soil fertility map, you see what customized fertilizer, which have been customized through a partnership with the Agricultural Transformation Agency, it is policy oriented, these kind of actions, can give tremendous results. In Nigeria, there is a presidential fertilizer initiative with tremendous results in terms of job creations, in terms of actually creating also an ecosystem. They revamped blenders that were sat idle for years. Very interestingly, the two things interesting in terms of the financing gap and why the last question you ask is, where do we see the challenges as a company? It is in terms of financing, but it is mainly in terms of perception. In this case, the financing gap was covered almost entirely by the National Sovereign Fund that saw the market failure in financing and financed the revamping of the, for example, of the fertilizer plants, but also infrastructure. So you'll bear with me, this is only 30 seconds. It's a video, and I will conclude 30 seconds after the video to really illustrate this financing gap.
I was able to work with the Nigerian Railway Corporation to revive a lot of train coaches to be on this track. We have a rail track into the port. When the phosphate came from Morocco, we loaded 20 wagons to Funtua. We've loaded another 20 wagons to Kaduna twice. We've loaded to Mina twice. We've loaded to Bauchi. We've loaded to Bokkos. And interestingly, these locations are locations that train have not been between 25 to 27 years. They have not seen train. But with the instead of this presidential fertilizer initiative, we're using the rail track.
So, I apologize for the publicity, but the key point here is this is a railroad that had not been used for 25 years and was, became operational for a single purpose, which is distributing fertilizer. Well, as you can imagine, it can also become, it can be used for other things. The financing gap is the following. We are investing more than $4 billion in fertilizer production in Africa. But to make rapid growth, we need an ecosystem of companies. The deal flow you mentioned, there is a deal flow that we are de-risking. And that deal flow should be really the focus of development agencies and financing institutions, because we can enter a virtuous circle for rapid growth. Thank you very much.